Hello and welcome to the channel where we share the myths, legends and histories of the Chinese people from the first creators to the last imperial dynasty. More than 6,000 years of story, one video at a time. My name is Aping Oh, I am the chain smoking writer. If you feel like you would like to join us on this journey through time, please consider subscribing to the channel. Now, in a previous episode, we mentioned that in Yao's later days as a ruler of the land, his greatest headache was actually the problem of succession. We all know that his son was basically a waste of oxygen. So he had to look for successors elsewhere. Today's little story is about a person, a man, that was in serious consideration by Yao to be his successor. So what's his story and what makes it so interesting? And why is he remembered until today? It was said that during Yao's reign, there lived a sage named Xu You. Now, he was known to be an extremely disciplined man who held himself to an extremely high standard of conduct. Xu You was known to be a virtuous and learned man who prized knowledge above all material wealth. And he had a solid reputation for his noble character and his impeccable integrity. So when Yao heard about Xu You, he was intrigued, or he was really interested to make him his successor. And so Yao paid Xu You a personal visit. Now when Yao saw Xu You, he said, "When the sun rises in the sky, its brilliance lights up the entire world, but the candle continued burning in its feeble attempt to compete with the sun." Now, isn't that laughable? The rains and the dew nourishes all plant life on land. However, some men still try to water their crops with ladles of water. Now, isn't that a waste of effort? You, good sir, would definitely bring about great prosperity to the people if you rule. But alas, I am on the throne. I feel embarrassed and a sense of guilt to the people for holding on to this position for so long. Now please, great Xu You, let me abdicate the throne to you." Having heard what Yao said, Xu You just nonchalantly replied as follows, "Oh, great ruler, your reign is known for being just and peaceful, and the people live good lives under your rule. I will not take your position for the sake of fame and benefits to myself. You see, when a bird builds a nest in the woods, all it wants is a branch for itself. And when a mole drinks from the river, all it wants is to quench its thirst. Now please return and do not bring this matter up again. For I have no use for a kingdom, nor do I have a desire to rule." Of course, Yao would not take no for an answer, because he truly believed in his heart that Xu You had what it takes, because of his reputation and his virtues and his status in the hearts of the people. He believed that Xu You would have what it takes to ensure the peace and prosperity will continue after he is no longer a ruler. So Yao tried to persuade Xu You over and over again to take the throne, you know, using all ways and means, sending messengers, sending envoys, paying personal visits. It got to the point where Xu You was so annoyed and so desperate to get away from this attention that Xu You changed his name and moved into the mountains to escape the attention of Yao. Now the place Xu You escaped to, you know, in his desperate attempt to escape Yao's attention, was this place called Qishan in today's Henan province, actually, to the north, which is to the north of Yingshui or the Ying River. And there he, you know, tried to settle down and live incognito as a, you know, common farmer. And that went on for a while until Yao once again found him. So Xu You managed to live, you know, pretty peacefully for a few years before Yao found him again. And At this time, Yao was even more anxious about the matter of succession because his son, Tan Zhu, as we mentioned earlier, has proven to be incorrigible in his delinquent ways. Well, basically, he's proven once and for all that he is really a waste of oxygen. So, Yao managed to track down Shiyou's location and he once again sends envoys and messengers to persuade Shiyou to at least take up a position as a regional governor. Now, the idea behind it is that, you know, if he wouldn't take the throne outright, let him at least get him into government, and then, you know, once he's in, we can just start promoting him and finally make him the ruler, you know, whether he wants it or not. Now, when Shiyou heard the proposal, the offer, the new offer to become a regional governor or regional chief, he was livid. In fact, he felt insulted because in his mind, his thinking was that you could not shake my resolve even when you offered me the throne. What makes you think a lower position of a regional chief or regional government would change anything? This is insulting to my character, to my integrity, to everything that I stand for. And, you know, he just drove these messengers away, pushed them out of his house, basically kicked them out of the house, and he ran to the riverbank near his place, near his abode, and he started scooping up water to wash his ears out, to show that he would not listen to any more talk of these matters. And when Shiyou was furiously scrubbing his ears by the river, another hermit living in the region named Chao Fu was leading his little calf to have a drink at the river. And, you know, seeing this weird man scrubbing his ears by the river, you know, of course you'll feel like, what the hell is this guy up to, man? So he inquired Shiyou about the reason for this weird behavior. Like, dude, the heck are you doing, man? You know? And so Shiyou, you know, being the grumpy old man that he is by now, he grumpily told Cao Fu that, you know, the Emperor Yao had once again sent messengers to persuade him to leave the mountains and become an official of the court. And he felt that these banal and mundane words had tainted his ears and he needed to clean them out thoroughly. Now, having heard this answer, Cao Fu looked at Shiyou in derision and was like, what? Seriously? That's how high your bloody horse is? And Cao Fu basically just told Shiyou, like, you know, since you view the mundane world and all its people with such disdain, you should just move into the deepest parts of the mountains and cut all human contact. That way, you will no longer be known, you will no longer be recognized, and basically no one will ever see you, so, you know, no one can taint your ears with their banal chatter. You know, you presumptuous and pompous piece of... I mean, yeah, I guess Cao Fu had a point. By this time, to be very honest, my personal take on it, I look at this story and I go like, what's wrong with this fella, man? Like, seriously? You don't want a position? Fine. You don't have to, you know, get so high on your high horse and kind of like look down on the mundane world and everything in it. It's just ridiculous. I mean, just say no. No? Be glad that you are so recognized and so wanted and so required. If you don't want to do it, say no. No need to feel insulted. In fact, I think it's insulting that you feel insulted. But anyways, back to the story. Cao Fu did not stop there. He continued barraging this Shiyou. He said, now isn't that why you chose to live as a hermit here? I mean, so that you could enhance, you know, your standing and your reputation of having a high moral ground and, you know, your unassailable virtues. You said that you dislike the servants' banal chatter and their mundane offers. You said that this talk of giving you the throne is tainting your ears. Now, let me tell you this, you stubborn old fool. I hate even more the fact that your ears are polluting the water of this river. And with that, Cao Fu stormed away, leading his calf upstream so that it could drink water that is untainted by Shi Yu's ear washing. So after all that, you know, scolding and barraging by this Cao Fu, Shi Yu felt extremely embarrassed, shamed, and even more insulted. And Shi Yu, you know, being the stubborn old man that he is, he just like, you know, you think I wouldn't do what you just said? I'll do exactly that. He hung his ladle on the cliff of the south bank of the Yong River, and he really moved into the deepest parts of the woods, deepest parts of Qi Mountain, where he was never seen again. There, apparently, he slept in the trees in summer, and in winter, he moved into the caves. He ate fruits when he was hungry and drank from the rivers when he was thirsty. And years later, when people found his body, or whatever's left of it, they buried him on the peak of Qi Mountain, Qi Shan. And till this day, Qi Mountain in Henan is still known as Shi Yu Mountain or Shi Yu Shan. Yeah, poets and scholars throughout history have, in a way, shown their admiration for Shi Yu by, you know, composing countless poems and odes to him, you know, immortalizing the man and his resolve. And apparently, he is a high moral standing and he is an impeccable character for the very simple fact that, you know, he refused to take the throne no matter how Yao was offering it to him or how much he was recognized. He would rather live as a caveman in the woods and die sad and lonely, I guess. Maybe not sad, but definitely lonely. He would rather die in the woods as a caveman than to be the ruler of the land. And to a lot of these Confucian academics and scholars, apparently that is a virtue and a proof of high moral standing and impeccable character. Yeah. So that's the story of Shi Yu. I hope you like this story and you found it interesting. If you do, it will help the channel out a lot if you could just smash the like button. Yeah. And if you would like to follow us and join us on this journey through time and you'd like to see more content like this, please consider subscribing to the channel and clicking on the bell icon so you will be notified whenever a new video drops. And you can support the channel and support my work on Patreon and other social media sites. All the links are available below, and if you have any feedback or any thoughts, please leave your comments in the comment section below. I usually will personally look through all the comments and reply to all of them if possible. I guess that's it for today, and I'll see you in the next episode.